knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In this series, we have learned about how minerals crystallize from liquid hot magma to form igneous rocks, which over time are uplifted, broken down into sediments, transported, and eventually deposited in a basin, where they are buried, compacted, and cemented to become sedimentary rock. In this tutorial, we will discuss what happens when a sedimentary or igneous rock gets squashed in between two colliding plates, and the tremendous pressures and temperatures that result cause the original rock to recrystallize. We are, of course, talking about metamorphism, and this is the origin of our third and final type of rock, metamorphic rock. Metamorphism is defined as any change in the mineralogy or physical structure of a rock by natural processes, such as increased pressure and temperature, or the introduction of chemically active fluids without melting it into magma. To truly understand metamorphism, we must understand that every mineral has a range of physical conditions, such as temperature and pressure, as well as chemical conditions over which it is stable. When the conditions move out of a mineral's stability range, it will break down into other, more stable minerals. This is why igneous rocks undergo chemical weathering at the surface. Minerals that form in an igneous environment are stable at very high temperatures, where both oxygen and water are scarce, but they are not stable in the water and oxygen-rich conditions at the surface. Therefore, they react to form more stable minerals like clay. Diagenesis can also be thought of as super low-grade metamorphism, where the slightly increased pressures and temperatures deep within a sedimentary basin can cause recrystallization of minerals like calcite. However, when geologists talk about metamorphism, they are referring to rocks that recrystallize at temperatures greater than 200 degrees Celsius, far above the realm of diagenesis. Metamorphism is classified based on both its intensity and its pressure with respect to temperature, which corresponds to the tectonic environment where metamorphism took place. Metamorphic intensity can be classified as either low grade, medium grade, or high grade, with low grade describing the pressure and temperature conditions above the realm of diagenesis, high grade encompassing the conditions up until melting begins, and medium grade being in between. When examining a metamorphic rock, its metamorphic grade can be determined by the amounts of recrystallization and foliation. To put this into context, let's take a mudstone, which is a sedimentary rock primarily composed of clay minerals, and progressively metamorphose the rock. As we increase the temperature to around 300 degrees Celsius and add a few kilobars of pressure, the platy and elongate minerals will begin to align perpendicular to the direction of greatest stress. This transformation is most radical in rocks that are rich in sheet silicates, like clay, muscovite, and biotite. In rocks, this alignment of platy minerals is said to create foliation, or cleavage, and the beginning of the development of cleavage is what defines a low-grade metamorphic rock, which is called slate. Slate makes great building stones because of its good cleavage, which causes it to break along nice planar surfaces. As we continue to ramp up the pressure and temperature to around 400 degrees Celsius and 5 kilobars, the clay minerals will begin to recrystallize into other sheet silicates, most commonly muscovite and chlorite, which will grow with their sheets, or basal cleavage, lining up perpendicular to the main stress, further enhancing the rock's cleavage. These medium-grade metamorphic rocks are distinguished from slate by the onset of recrystallization, which gives it a lustrous sheen. At the lower end of medium-grade metamorphism, the recrystallized micas are very fine-grained, having the appearance of glitter. This type of rock is called phyllite. Closer to the upper limit, recrystallization increases to the point where the individual mica grains become easily visible to the naked eye. This rock is called schist. In addition to mica, schists may contain other visible minerals, such as garnet dodecahedra or prismatic grains of amphibole. Once the temperature and pressure surpass around 600 degrees Celsius and 8 kilobars, the previously stable chlorite and muscovite become unstable and react with quartz to form more stable minerals such as potassium feldspar, garnet, sillimanite, and biotite. The characteristic feature of high-grade metamorphic rocks is the segregation of the mafic and felsic minerals during recrystallization, which manifests as alternating bands of light and dark minerals. Rocks that display this type of foliation are called gneiss. Now that we understand how metamorphic rocks form, let's move forward and get a closer look at the different types of metamorphism, so we can better understand the different types of metamorphic rocks.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.